Hello and welcome. My name is Jonathan Vita, and in this video we're going to be looking at Sissela Bach, and we're going to go through her book Lying, Moral Choice in Public and Private Life. And now we're moving on to a chapter on truthfulness, deceit, and so on and so forth. Now Sissela Bach describes two kinds of assault. You can think of ways to, you know, harm or impugn other human beings. And she says two clear ways that we can infringe on others is through deceit and through violence. These are both ways to assault others. And so if we think of all these different ways we can do violence to someone, think of all those different outcomes that you can accomplish just by using deception. And she's trying to make an analogy that deception can be not a form of violence, but a kind of assault, a cousin to violence. So think about how in deception, there are ways that you can coerce others. That is, that you can cause them to act in ways that they do not want to act. That is, by telling something false, their beliefs are shifted into doing something. You know, they believe the world is one way, so they're going to act in light of that false belief. And likewise, you can cause someone to do things that are very, very contrary to their belief structure, their character, because they have been thrown into this bizarro world of lies. Now, it doesn't have to be that you have to undermine everything they believe to be true. It could just be a simple statement that is so pointed, so precise, that it undermines an important relationship. And so this can force someone to do things that they don't want to do. And this is called coercion. You can coerce someone into doing things. But you can also think about all the different kinds of harms that you can cause to someone. That is, that you can make people feel bad by the things that you say that are not true. You can cause people to do things that will be self-destructive. So this is coercion in a way that brings harm, physical harm to them, emotional harm, psychological harm. There's lots of different ways to harm people. And insofar as lies can actually bring that outcome, then deceit is a way to assault someone. Now, what's interesting is that when you think about our just general nature of wanting to be social to some extent. I mean, not everybody's an extrovert, but our desire to work with other people, to have peace with other people, to just have like some number of friends and work well with them, and be able to go to the store and be able to make purchases and, you know, things like that. Society just doesn't work unless people cooperate. But cooperation requires a bunch of different things. One of them being that we kind of a meeting of the minds, that we come to have the same kinds of beliefs about what's going on. That, for example, we both know where the store is, that we both know what the price is, that we both know, you know, how to get this good, you know, and use it, that this is still valuable and so on. And that's just talking about the store. Suppose for many other things where you're cooperating at your job or for your work of some sort, you need to be able to be on the same page as other people to cooperate. All of this is undermined if we get a sufficient number of people who no longer want to cooperate by bringing in false statements to sever the meeting of the minds. By meeting of the minds, I mean you and I both have beliefs that correspond to each other. We have a sort of agreement or correspondence with our beliefs. When we are agreeing to do things, we both think the same thing about that agreement. Society can't function without enough people being honest. If you have a lot of people being liars, everyone's going to be on guard, and no one can really trust each other very well. You have to prove a lot harder how, like, what somebody believes is true, that what someone's saying is not just going to be a lie, something to give them an advantage over you. We have this both need and this practical goal to just cooperate with each other. Lies undermine this. There's this famous quote that by Samuel Johnson that even in hell, the demons cannot survive on lies all the time, because even there they need to be able to cooperate. They can't be deceiving each other all the time. They need to, you know, have the truth sometimes. So if even demons have to have the truth sometimes, well, then of course you and I do too. But then all the more if we want a well-functioning society. When we lie, there is an effect of redistributing power. Notice that when I lie to you, I have something over you. Namely, I have one more true belief than you do, but it also may be that my having this belief is something that's depriving you of something that you want, or it inhibits your ability to succeed. When I lie to you, I am doing something that controls you. Namely, I am introducing a false belief because I might have different reasons for having you believe something false, namely for me to get ahead. So it can hide my certain kinds of purposes and motives behind things I want to do. It can hide my goals. It can hide my objectives. But also, it allows me to manipulate for you what kind of things are likely or possible or true. And so the options of what is available in the world, what things you can do. If I tell you that that Wegmans closes at 10 p.m. when it closes at midnight, you're effectively losing 2 hours of access to Wegmans. So I can manipulate the options that you have, limit what you're able to do. And when you consider different costs and benefits, like that Aldi has better prices on avocados or something like that, when maybe they don't that particular day, you're now assessing the world very differently. You're making different buying decisions, expending different time differently. You're weighing the costs and benefits of going to different stores, partly just because I told you something that's false. And so I have power that you don't. Namely, I know where to get a better price for avocados than you. Now, that might not sound like that big of a deal, but this is a much bigger deal when it's talking about like private and personal relationships, especially with friends and family. Moreover, if you have a belief about what you ought to be doing, if I feed you false information, that can undermine your confidence in what you believe is right. I'm undermining your ability to not necessarily just reason, but also to weigh your options rationally. I'm getting rid of, to some extent, your confidence. You might have excellent reason to believe something, but if I insert a lie, it reduces your certainty. And this reduction in certainty means it's going to affect your life in some ways. Now, all of these are ways that I can impact your life just by telling you something that's false and convincing you of it. And so, to the extent that these are not just mundane examples, but ones in which they actually threaten your well-being, well then obviously it's an assault. Sissela invites us to think about lies from two different perspectives. First, the perspective of the deceived, and then the perspective of the deceiver. So let's talk about the perspective of the deceived. I want you to think about, just in your own position, a time that you've been lied to, where someone has lied to you. How did that situation make you feel? Now, I'm not interested in being your therapist. I want you to be thinking about what kinds of relationships, what kinds of consequences, what kinds of violations are involved in a lie. And so if I ask you how you felt when you were lied to, what specific things came to your mind? What kinds of consequences happened when someone lied to you? When a friend lied to you? When a sibling lied to you? When a coworker lied to you? How did that make you feel? What kinds of things are you thinking now? Are you thinking of a violation of your dignity? Is it that it actually caused you distress? Some emotional harm? Did it cause you to do something that, if you knew the truth, you would have been better to do? Let's get a little bit deeper into this. When we think about the impact of a lie, we can talk about a lot of different consequences. And if we were to just focus on the impact on the one who is deceived, then we can kind of think of a few things. One, if you are told something that you had a right to know, and someone told you something false about that, and suppose it's been going on for years. Suppose it's been going on for years. You've been believing the story and taking it as true, and it's factored into conversations that you've had, actions that you've taken, and so on. You might then, when you find out the truth, retrace all those different memories that were based on that belief. And think about all your actions that were based on that belief. A common experience, for example, that people might have is when they find out that they were adopted. Now, there is no shame in being adopted. My wife is adopted. I hope someday that we can adopt. And there are plenty of other people I know who have been adopted. Now, suppose you were told that you were not adopted, but biological child, and you find out that you are adopted, then all the different times in which they have communicated the same thought over and over again, or interacted with you in a way which assumed that you believed you were not adopted, or how they talked about kids who are adopted, you have now a way to reevaluate a good chunk of your life. Why? Because this is pretty central to who you are, is how you think of yourself in relationships, specifically in your family. Now, again, there's nothing wrong with being adopted. In many ways, it's a beautiful picture of absolute love in selecting people who often are vulnerable. But if you've been lied to about this, it hurts. It hurts a lot. And it makes you question a lot of different things about who you are, what you've done, and specifically, your relationship with the person who lied to you. You can also talk about your feeling of being controlled. If someone has lied to you, part of the reason they lied to you is because they wanted you to believe something false. And that by itself is enough to say that they are trying to control you. Namely, they want you to believe something false, and they caused you to do it. They forced your brain into having a certain kind of belief. And that is controlling. But there are lots of different ways where people tell you something false because they want you to act a certain way. And that is itself a kind of disrespectful way of having people run their lives. If you are telling someone something false, because you want them to live a certain way, then you're basically saying, I don't trust you to live the way that I want you to. I don't trust you in the way that you have enough sense to do the right thing. So I'm going to tell you something false so that it controls you. And beyond just feeling controlled, there's also different harms that you feel. The feeling of betrayal, the feeling of lack of trust, of isolation, being alone, because the people you care about don't care enough to tell you the truth. You can also talk about the indirect impact that lies can have on those who are deceived. Specifically, when you are told something false, you are more likely to repeat it. And this means that a lie can get spread quickly, because a lie can be repeated over and over and over, and so there can be a chain of lies spreading from the person who was first deceived. Now, the person who is deceived, they might not know that the belief is false. They might not know that they've been deceived. So when they communicate it to their friends or family or whoever they're talking to, they have all the credibility and belief and none of the the maliciousness, the malintent of deception, that now they have, confidence and trust of those who hear them, for them to now have their guard down to believe something that's false. Rumors, for example, plague this specific phenomenon. And this means that you are not only being deceived, but you're being used to deceive others. And so this means that your influence in being deceived has an impact on a lot of other people, or it can have an impact on a lot of other people and harm many people. And this is just through you being deceived. You don't even have to try to do it. You might just be perpetuating harmful statements or lies, not knowing that they're harmful or not knowing that they're lies. Now, for Sissela Bock, she thinks that a lot of this shows that we have like a prima facie duty to tell the truth. A prima facie duty to tell the truth. This means that we have an obligation that can be overridden to tell the truth. And so we should think that the truth automatically has some weight to it. Consider this a quote from Aristotle. Falsehood is in itself mean and culpable, and truth noble and full of praise. The idea here is that falsehood is, vicious or vile and blameworthy. But when you come to talking about the truth, it has a character to it of being noble, of being virtuous, of not being blameworthy, but being praiseworthy. And so the way that Sissela Bock tries to capture this sentiment, is not to say that falsehood and truth are diametrically opposed in that falsehood is always wrong and truth is always good, but instead to just make this as a general claim that most falsehoods are wrong and most truths are good, and we can distinguish the two partly by their weight. There is, as she says, an initial imbalance or asymmetry in the evaluation of truth-telling and lying. Lying requires a reason, while truth-telling does not. It must be excused. Reasons must be produced in any one case to show why a particular lie is not mean and culpable. So the idea here is specifically that truth, you don't need to come up with a good reason to tell the truth. It's just automatically there. It's got like some automatic force to it, automatic weight to it. But when it comes to lying, you need to overcome all of the different reasons not to tell a lie in order to say that actually this specific lie can be justified. This specific lie has enough weight to it that it overrides telling the truth in this circumstance. We have to actually show, to demonstrate, why this particular lie isn't vicious. It isn't evil. It requires an explanation. It requires a justification. Truth doesn't have that. It automatically has value in itself. Sissela Bock invites us to consider not only the perspective of the deceived, but also of the deceiver, that is, the liar. And so if we're getting into the perspective of someone who lies, I want you to be thinking about a time in which you have lied to someone. So go back, whether it was last week, last month, last year, last decade. I'm sure for many people it's not. You have to go to the last decade. You can figure out one in the last month or so. Recall a time that you have lied to someone. There are lots of different things that go into lying. So how did that specific situation make you feel? How did it actually come upon you that you felt a lie was either justified or that you wanted to lie? What made you feel that way? And what was the result? How did it make you feel after you made this lie, after you told this falsehood intending to deceive? You might think that there are many justifications for telling falsehood, namely that good things can happen, or at least that you can avoid harms. that you can, on the whole, think of the consequences and just say, there's going to be more happiness if I lie. I can avoid pain or suffering if I lie. And if that's a justification, that sounds pretty plausible, especially in the moment. Now, notice that if you are in a society where most people are cooperating and most people are telling the truth, there is this phenomenon called the free rider problem. So the free rider problem comes from the idea that there's a train, and the only reason this train is going to go down the tracks is because enough people pay tickets. Now, suppose someone hops onto the train without paying a ticket. Well, they're getting something that they didn't earn. They're getting something that they didn't pay for. They're getting something for free. And so this free rider is kind of exploiting a system where other people do their due. That is, that they pay what they're obligated to, but the free rider makes an exception for themselves and says, I don't need to. I don't need to pay that. I don't need a ticket. And so there's lots of different situations where you might have a free rider. Like, you need enough people in the country to pay taxes. If you evade taxes, you get basically all the same benefits as somebody who does pay taxes. You get, you know, all the different services, you get a generally peaceful society, and so on. But if you're not paying taxes, then you just got all those government benefits for free. The same thing goes for a bunch of different scenarios. Here's this. Suppose you tell a lie. You're basically saying the society around me can, in general, tell the truth. And after all, I do want everyone else to tell the truth because I want to know the truth. But I'm going to make an exception for myself. Not everybody has to tell the truth. Just everybody but me. Or most people, enough that I don't have to worry about distrusting people so that I can find out the truth reliably. But I don't have to tell the truth. Now, you could take a different tack, which would be just to say this. There are enough people out there in the world who are lying. Just like there are some people who say, well, I can evade taxes because this is just the way the system is. Like, other people evade taxes too. So you might say, well, there are enough people out there that since you want to get ahead and you know that there's already precedent that other people do the same thing to get ahead, they fudge the numbers on their taxes, or, for example, they tell lies occasionally. If it gets them ahead, if they don't get caught, then it's just like, well, then what's the big deal? Others lie, why can't I? But notice that if you are making the exception for yourself, you're basically saying, I'm okay having an unfair society, an unjust society, because some people are given, you know, a status where they don't get to suffer the consequences, even though they get all the benefits of a society where other people are obeying the law. Now, the people who are, you know, carrying out a lie, there may be some good justifications for it. But Sissela suggests that when people lie, usually, though not always, but usually, they misjudge the costs and benefits of telling a lie. They underestimate the harms and they overestimate the benefits or the advantages. They overestimate the benefits specifically of short term. So if they're trying to avoid pain, if they're trying to get ahead in something, some short amount of money, or to get a better deal, or to get people off their back, whatever. These types of things, they have a benefit, but it's a short-term benefit, and it doesn't mean that it's going to have a long-term benefit. It might just kick the can down the road, and you have to deal with the lie or the problem again in the future. So it prioritizes and perhaps is biased toward the immediate gratification. So it overestimates the benefits of short-term thinking. But somebody who lies also underestimates the risk of harm that it does to the liar. So this means that they underestimate the harms or the risk of harms done to themselves. Now, they may very well understand quite well the impact that it's going to have on the person they're lying to. They have a pretty decent idea what it's going to cause them to do or what it's going to make them believe. But they underestimate what it will do to themselves. Namely, when you lie, you threaten your reputation. You threaten your credibility. And those are hard to get back if you lose them. If you jeopardize your reputation and your credibility, this means that in the future, even if you only told the truth every day for a month, they still have good reason to suspect you when you say something that sounds not very likely. If it's not very likely, you have nothing of your character to recommend you, except that you don't lie, except in circumstances like a month ago. So you underestimate the risk of your reputation and your credibility being shot. But on top of that, if you lie, you underestimate how it impacts you in the long run, specifically how it shapes your habits and how it shapes your integrity. Namely, if you do one lie, it's easier to do another. There are many cases where you, in saying a lie, have to cover that lie with yet another lie and yet another lie. And so opening that first door to lie sets yourself up to commit yourself to more lies, because you have to keep lying in order for your pseudo world to be coherent, to work. And so you're having to acquire now a habit and rethink who you are in that you allow these kinds of things to come out of your mouth. You allow these kinds of things to color your relationships. You are okay with certain kinds of infractions and violations of other people's dignity. And so if you lie, you actually increase not just the likelihood that you're going to do something wrong and again, it actually taints your character so that you actually are worse off because of it. But even if we don't just look at the individual liar and the benefits that that liar might have, they underestimate not just the impact that it has on the person who's deceived, but on the broader society, of the broader community. As I was saying before, the person who is lied to can spread this information. If you are telling someone a lie and it spreads, you've now infected your community with this lie. Now, this community could just be your office. It could just be your family. It might be something that is not very well repeated. But, after all, you are passing on information that you have given your stamp of approval to be passed on to others. But even if it weren't to be spread significantly, you are somebody's role model, almost certainly. And you are somebody's colleague, almost certainly. Or at least you will be. And so to the extent that you are open and willing to lie, you can infect your character, you can infect your community with having bad character. One that makes it so that on your team at your job, on your team, you permit lies. On your team, we don't have to be entirely honest with one another. On your team, we can fudge numbers. On your team, we're going to do what we have to. We're going to say what we need to in order to get ahead. And that kind of thing affects the way your coworkers work. It affects the way your manager sees you, but it also affects your peers. And so whether you're a role model or a colleague or somebody else, people do see your character. And if you lie, then they see your character and they might be enabled to mimic your behavior. They might imitate you. Now, Sissela Bach has asked us to look through both perspectives of the deceived and the deceiver. And she says that it's actually really helpful for us to kind of go back and forth between those two perspectives to better understand why people lie and why people don't like being lied to. And this is easily summed up in thinking of the golden rule, that we ought to do unto others as we would have done to us. So you know how you want to be treated. You can't be expected to do less than, or I'm sorry, you are to be expected to do at least as much as you would want somebody to do for you. You can't be expected necessarily to do more than what you expect of others. So if you wouldn't want to be lied to, then this makes a very easy prescription. You wouldn't lie to others then. And so since you know what it's like to be lied to, this might be enough. Enough information, enough data for you to recognize the wrongness of a lie. You might be able to think of all the different factors that go into your head why, when someone lies to you, you feel violated, you feel wronged, or maybe you don't take it very seriously. It gives you enough information to be assessing the situation from your perspective. And this is helpful because from your perspective, you might be able to put yourself in somebody else's shoes and use the information that you have because people are very similar to you. Sissela Bach gives us this principle of veracity. And the idea here is this is one where we're upholding the truth. So what is this? What does it look like? Well, the first idea is that truth-telling has greater weight than telling lies. So the principle of veracity has to do with our being inclined toward the truth and disinclined away from lies. That lies need justification. Truth-telling doesn't require justification. Truth-telling has weight of its own. If you tell a lie, it has to have enough weight. It has to have enough force so that it would be tipping the scale. So we've got this one aspect, but on the other, we can talk about it in a different way. Specifically, that lying could be seen as then a last resort. That the principle of veracity says, basically, that if you have a lot of different options, consider all your options. If any of them involves not lying, and it's a viable option, then you ought to do that one over lying, especially if they have the same outcome. So in any situation where a lie is a possible choice, you got to look for truthful alternatives. And if none of the truthful alternatives works, if none of them works, then lying is now a live option. It wasn't a live option until you found out all the truthful ones were no longer live options. And so lying is a last resort. You can do a lie, she wants to say, in some circumstances, but the situation has to call for it. So what does this then mean? Does this rule out all lies, or does it just require extreme circumstances? How should we go about this? Now, she doesn't think that it rules out all lies, as I've just said, but does it require extreme circumstances? What kind of circumstances would be extreme enough to require a lie? What kinds of situations need to, or considerations need to come into mind in order for a lie to be justified?